is a special presentation from WLKY. Help cure type 1 diabetes.
Good evening, I'm Vicki George.
And I'm Jay Cardosi. It's upsetting, it's life-threatening, and it never goes away.
It's type 1 diabetes, and 1.2 million Americans have it. Over the next hour, we will share some of their stories, their struggles, and their successes. While there is no cure, your donations tonight can help turn type 1 into type none.
And type 1 diabetes can strike both children and adults at any age. It happens when the person's pancreas stops producing insulin, a hormone that allows us to turn food into energy. It has nothing to do with diet or lifestyle. There's nothing you can do to prevent it, and there's nothing you can do to get rid of it, at least for right now.
From finger pricks to insulin injections, people with type 1 diabetes are reminded of the disease 24/7. Treatment options are improving, from insulin pumps and continuous glucose meters to the artificial pancreas. But these advances cannot happen without research, and that research needs funding. That's why your donations are desperately needed.
Yeah, and to make a pledge, it's really easy to do. Just give us a call, 502-893-3232. Again, 502-893-3232. Phone lines are open right now. We have volunteers standing by to take your call, all of them impacted by type 1 diabetes. Now, Rick Van Hoos is in the interviewing room, so to speak. Rick, what's the latest?
Well, you all said it all. We need your help tonight, folks. Your donations benefit JDRF, the leading global organization working to better treat, prevent, and eventually cure type 1 diabetes. Any donation can help change a person's life. JDRF is led by people with personal connections to type 1 diabetes, like these wonderful volunteers. I have 8 of them here. They'll be changing in and out throughout the night, doing a terrific job for us, taking your calls and your money to help us out here. They're the driving force behind JDRF, and they want to hear from you tonight. All you have to do is call 893-3232. Anything you can spare will help lead to finding a cure for those who have already given. We want to say a big thank you. Mary Dossett is, hi, one of the executive directors with JDRF. Thank you for being here.
Thank you for having us. This is amazing.
We have an hour here. Give us your best speech. What do we need to get these phones ringing?
I think you all are saying it very, very well. It is donations that, like the ones coming across the phones today, that make a cure possible. And that is the most amazing thing about working for JDRF. When we find a cure, you can say that you and all of these people and everybody out there are the ones that made it happen.
We have some of the ambassador youth behind us. We're going to be hearing from them, from Jay and Vicky. But, it's the driving force behind
JDRF. Absolutely. No child should have to endure what our kids endure. But they do it with bravery, and they do it with commitment. And we do it with commitment, and we're dedicated. We are going to find a cure for type 1 diabetes.
I like that attitude.
Let's do it.
All right. Thank you so much for being here and your time, Mary. Once again, the number to call, 893-3232. Let's go back over to Vicky and Jay.
All right, thanks a lot, Rick. JDRF was founded by parents determined to find a cure for their children with type 1 diabetes. It's now a powerhouse in the scientific community, having funded nearly $2 billion in research. That's a B.
My goodness, that's great. Hey, one of the many people dedicated to its success with the hopes of one day wiping out type 1 diabetes for good is local JDRF Development Manager Mackenzie Longoria. Mackenzie, thanks very much for joining us tonight.
Absolutely. Thank you guys so much for having me.
Why did you get involved with JDRF?
Well, it's actually very interesting because I'm actually a lawyer by trade, and I didn't really enjoy the practice of law, and I had no connection to type 1. And then I met my executive director, Mary Dossett, started meeting some of the families, and I thought, this is an exceptional cause. It's an exceptional organization to work for. And I think what really did it for me is when I found out how much money that we raise actually goes to research. So we send about 74% of funds raised directly to type 1 research.
Well, let's talk a little bit about that and how important awareness is and the difference between type 1, type 2. Type 2 is, what are you going to try to get across to the folks during your tenure?
Sure. So one thing that's really important for us, and you kind of touched on that, is differentiating between type 1 and type 2. I think there's a lot of misconceptions, and people hear diabetes and they just assume that it's related to lifestyle choices or perhaps what you eat, and it's something that you've almost brought on into your life. Type 1 is nothing to do with how you eat or whether or not you exercise. It's completely about your pancreas, you know, not producing insulin anymore. So one of my goals is to further educate people. So not just fundraising, but also doing enough outreach and mentoring and education so that people understand the differences between type 1 and type 2, and they understand who we are at JDRF and what our mission is.
Research is very valuable. Of course, I've known my mom is type 1 diabetic, and I know in her lifetime how much advances have been made in research. Tell us some of the things that they're working on. What's some of the breakthroughs?
Absolutely. It's been very exciting, and I've learned a lot in the 7 months that I've been with JDRF. And probably some of the most exciting technologies that are coming out is the artificial pancreas. We actually had a staffer in our office that was able to do a trial with the artificial pancreas, and it was incredibly beneficial for him during the time that he was able to be on it. Another exciting method is encapsulation. We're also working on smart insulin. So we have all these different technologies and research efforts that are geared towards prevention, dealing with complications and side effects, treatment, and then ultimately we still continue to work to find a cure.
Pretty neat stuff.
It certainly is.
Mackenzie, we'll be talking with you a little bit later on during the broadcast. Yeah. A lot more information to get across, but a lot of exciting developments for sure.
Thanks for your hard work, and thanks for joining us
tonight.
About 200,000 people younger than age 20 have type 1 diabetes.
Carolyn Callahan introduces us to a young Shelbyville family battling the disease times two.
Oh, I want a zip line.
This is Wyatt Hurst's view as he runs through his Shelbyville backyard. He spends a lot of time here playing with his sister, Sophie.
She's very aware of her care. You know, she's very aware of her brother's care. And
what you don't see,
it forces them to grow up fast,
is the disease that's changed their lives.
Multiple injections a day, you know, up to 10 blood sugar checks, and, you know, and then we have that times two.
Sophie and Wyatt both have type 1 diabetes.
Still, when we say it out loud that we have two kids with type 1, I feel like that's just, it's crazy.
Wyatt was diagnosed first a year and a half ago.
He was constantly having bathroom issues and thirst.
In March, Sophie had the same bathroom issues, and her mom had a hunch what was going on.
I just decided to use his meter and test her sugar, and she was 558. So we called Dad and said, we're headed to the hospital.
Josh and Malia Hurst couldn't believe it. They have no family history of the disease.
I think the first one was, there was so much fear because we knew nothing. And then when we started researching, we knew just how dangerous it was. And so there was so much fear. And with the second, there was that fear. But on top of that, it was just deer in the headlights. Like, this cannot be happening.
With each diagnosis, their lives changed.
We went from somewhat of a carefree childhood for them to cabinets full of, you know, needles and insulin and alcohol swabs and all of this stuff. And, you know, that was just overnight.
They're all in it together, but sometimes it's tough for mom and dad.
Some days we feel like we do everything right. You know, we've measured food, we've carb counted, we've done everything on a precise time, and the insulin, you know, we've done it all. And that requires so much effort, which, you know, you'll do for your children, of course, but, yeah. And then you still do the checks, and you have days where it's just way off.
And the kids.
There are days that both of our kids, and sometimes both at the same time, say, I wish I didn't have this, and I wish I didn't have to deal with this. And while we also wish that same thing, we've met other people and seen other people that also have struggles, and some of them bigger struggles.
They're thankful for JDRF and the medical advancements taking place. They have supportive family and friends who have learned how to take care of the kids and are always willing to help. The kids watch out for each other.
They've learned how to get tough when they have to.
And mom and dad are their biggest advocates.
And I don't think that they should have to have 10 blood sugar checks a day and, you know, 6 injections and have to have a math equation for every meal that you have. I mean, that's just, you know, we need a cure.
And joining us right now, Sophie, Wyatt, and their parents, Josh and Malia. Thank you very much for joining us, guys. Really appreciate it. And you guys have had a tough road just recently, right? I mean, these two were just diagnosed recently, and we're talking two times the difficulties, right? Talk a little bit about that, Malia.
Yes, Wyatt was diagnosed when he was 5, so that was been about a year and a half ago. And we have no family history of type 1. We knew nothing, you know, so when he was diagnosed, it was a complete shock. And we knew that that was a reality, that if you had one with type 1, that that would be a greater risk for another sibling. But because we had no family history, we just really didn't have that on our brains at all, that that would happen. And then in March, Sophie was diagnosed, and she's 8. So she was just recently diagnosed.
What were her symptoms? Were you surprised, or were doctors surprised that at age 8 she was diagnosed after her brother?
No, they didn't lead on that they were surprised about that. Of course we were. We had that in the back of our mind, but it was way in the back of our minds that that would ever happen.
What were her symptoms?
Constant urination, using the restroom a lot of drinking water, drinking fluids. We were really lucky because she didn't get sick. Because with him, we were already aware of those things. We took her sugar, and it was 558, so we immediately had to go straight to the hospital. She was very scared because she knew the reality before. So when he was diagnosed, you know, it was, we didn't know much and he didn't know much. So he didn't have a fear in the beginning, but she was very scared. It was very terrifying for her.
So you guys are busy at home helping Sophie and Wyatt. So why get involved with JDRF? I know you've got to be so busy.
You know what? We are busy, but we are going to be the best advocates for our kids. I think any parent would feel that way. JDRF is an amazing organization. Right away, somebody reached out to us and said, how can we help you? Just connect with other families. Type 1 is one of those things that there's a lot involved there. A lot of education, a lot of injections, a lot of carb counting. There's, you know, it's a science project and a math project to eat a meal. So that's a, this organization is amazing that just says, how can we help you do that and connect with people and make life a little easier, because it is hard. It's very hard. It's to say it's 24/7 is an understatement.
Now, Josh, you guys said that you're orchestrating a fundraising event in Shelbyville, right? Talk a little bit about that.
Yes, sir. We just decided this year to give back to an organization that means a lot to us. And my wife has put a lot of work in. And we're doing a 5K, 3K, and obstacle course. And it's open to all ages, kids all the way up to adults. But it's out at Galrun Farms in Shelbyville. And we've got sponsorships available. If you Google the Mighty Pumpkin, okay, 5K, you can pull up the registration, and it's like a trail run that goes through the farm, obstacle course, and it'll be a fun day. It's and the farm is open. It's a fall festival, so there'll be activities even after the run and that sort of thing. But if you Google the Mighty Pumpkin, you can find it.
What is the date?
September the 17th.
Okay, terrific.
Sophie and Wyatt, are you guys looking forward to that? You're going to take part in that?
Don't know.
You know, one of the cool things about having diabetes is you got to be on TV. Has this been fun?
What do you want to say to your friend? Who's your best friend? Friends. Let's not leave anybody out.
He's got to think. He knows. We thank you guys for joining us. It's great to have you with us. It's nice to see your family. Looks like you're handling this very well.
Thank you.
All
right.
Thanks, guys. Let's send it over to Rick Van Hoos. He is in with the phone banks. Rick, we hope some folks are calling, making a pledge.
Hey, there are people, a few words there, but we've got to love the little ones for sure. This is our phone bank. These people are, how come your phones aren't, Don, your phone's not ringing back there. Mr. Luckett, your phone's not ringing. Let's get these phones ringing. 893-3232. WLKY is proud to partner up and help JDRF. It's a worthwhile cause. Besides that, you call in, you get your pledge read on the air, like Don Ceresi, $30. Thank you for your pledge. Beverly Dew, a $60 pledge. Thank you so much, Beverly. Sasha Hawks called in with a $100 pledge tonight. Every penny helps us here. That is for sure. And we have Brent Gilliland, $100 pledge, and Patrick Hall with another $50 pledge. You're going to be hearing from the youth a little bit later in this program. I want to bring in a gentleman right now that's in charge of the youth ambassadors for JDRF. This is Jeremy Irwin. Welcome, Jeremy.
Thank you so much for having us today.
All right. You're in charge of the kids, and the ambassadors go out and do what throughout the year?
Well, we have a great group of youth ambassadors. This is our second year doing it. So they're sort of the face of JDRF. So they go out and create awareness for type 1 diabetes and advocate for us. So they do things like do fundraisers at their school and teach the kids at their schools about type 1 diabetes. They go to our corporate sponsors and thank them for fundraising. And we have some of our great youth ambassadors here today taking calls and supporting us.
If you don't mind, for the folks at home that aren't sure about diabetes, explain the difference between type 1 and type 2.
Yeah, both are very devastating diseases, type 1 and type 2. The biggest difference is type 1 is an autoimmune disease. So there's basically your body attacks your pancreas and your body can't produce insulin anymore. We need insulin to survive. So
it gives the blood, the sugar delivers it to the cells.
That's right. So there's nothing you can do to cure type 1 diabetes. There's nothing that's happened that's caused type 1 diabetes, and you can't cure it from exercise or diet or anything like that. With type 2 diabetes, also, like I said, devastating disease, but it's more a lifestyle disease. Sometimes it's caused, of course, genetics, but also lifestyle, like
a little heavy.
Yeah, that's right. That's right. And it's also a lot of times type 2 diabetes you get later in life. Type 1 diabetes you can get at any age, but a lot of times you get it when you're younger, say in your younger years and your teen years. So.
All right. Well, we appreciate your efforts, and we look forward to seeing throughout this program the youth on here. I saw Madison on there. She said she's a gymnast. We'll see if we can do some tumbling. Maybe Vicky and Jay get her to tumble for us later.
That sounds great. I'd like to see that.
All right. Once again, the number to call, 893-3232. Jeremy, you were the good luck charm because all eight phones are currently being occupied. So keep calling in with your pledges. We'll read them out here on the air for you when you call in with a pledge tonight, helping us out here on WLKY for the JDRF Telethon.
All right. Thank you, Rick. Every dollar that JDRF puts toward research comes from donations.
And tonight, we're very lucky to have one of our corporate sponsors here with us presenting a check that will help us fund the fight against type 1 diabetes. Dr. Mark Lynn, president and CEO of VisionWorks, is joining us along with his son, Mark. Thank
Hello.
You very much.
Thanks for joining us.
This
yeah,
is awesome.
You got a big check behind you.
Let's, we do. We're hiding a little bitty check here. We want to make a donation.
Great.
Of $20,000 to the Juvenile Diabetes Wonderful. Research Foundation. This is just an amazing group. If you have kids and they have this, I don't want to call it a disease. If they have this issue, get them help. Yeah. They can be treated. They can be taken care of. They can be normal. That it's not a real issue. I mean, it's a problem. You have to be careful. You have to do your medicine. You have to follow what all the doctors say, but let the kids be kids. And
so $20,000 from VisionWorks to JDRF of Kentucky and Southern Indiana. You guys say no diabetes in your family. Why get involved with this worthy cause?
Well, what better of a worthy cause could you get involved with? My mom was borderline diabetic years ago, but due to other issues. But diabetes is one of the top things that affects the eye. There's no reason for a child, if they receive proper treatment, proper monitoring, that they should lose their vision and go blind due to diabetes. So we don't want that to happen. From our concern, that is our primary concern, but just healthy children in general. I mean, I'm very fortunate. My kids were all healthy. Mark's got three children. They're all healthy at this stage, and we feel very, very lucky. And what we want to do is give back.
It's actually hit close to home to me just a couple weeks ago. My daughter, who is just went to first grade, on the first day of school, she came home, and one of the students in the class, the mom had come to explain her son's insulin pump. Said it's a tiny little computer, and they had actually given all the kids JDRF wristbands. And so she came home with that wristband, and I said, oh my gosh, we're doing this today. That's so close. So this organization is just, they do tons of great work, not just to help for research, but also for teaching for the parents so that they can go and they know how to handle these situations as well.
It takes guys like you to help us out, and we certainly appreciate your help. VisionWorks, $20,000. Very nice.
Just amazing. Thank you, gentlemen.
Thank
do appreciate
guys.
It.
Rebecca Moody is a student at Highland Hills Middle School in Georgetown, Indiana. The sixth grader was diagnosed with type 1 diabetes when she was 2 years old.
Now, as Christina Moore reports, Rebecca is bringing awareness to the disease, and she's confident in finding a cure.
How far is a scale when we look at it on our maps?
I feel like I'm just the same. I feel like I'm just not different, but special in a way.
At Highland Hills Middle School, Rebecca Moody fits right in. But life for this sixth grader is a little different than most of her classmates.
Rebecca had just started preschool, and I just noticed a sudden change in her behavior. She was just really very emotional, just not herself.
At 2 years old, Rebecca's mother says something wasn't quite right. She immediately took her to the doctor.
And when they came back in the room, they said, you need to go to COSAIR. We believe your daughter has type 1 diabetes. And still at that point, I really didn't even know what that meant.
That day, Rebecca's blood sugar level was 700. Normal, healthy levels are around 90 to 120. Her family quickly learned a new way of life with type 1 diabetes.
I learned that it wasn't my fault that I got it. We couldn't do anything to prevent it. I've learned up to just grow with it and to deal with it. And if someone bugs me with it, I just ignore them.
Rebecca says she's learned how to adjust to accommodate her health needs, even during one of her favorite activities, playing tennis.
I'll wear my CGM, a continuous glucose monitor, which tells me my number 24/7. So then if I start to feel low, I can check it without even pricking my finger. And then if I start to get low, I'll take a few tablets, probably sit out for a few minutes, then jump back right back in.
Rebecca feels lucky to be able to educate her community about her disease. Her mother hopes for a cure. And in the meantime, she hopes it's easier for other families to get diagnosed.
It is a simple finger prick. And it was one that our doctor's office wasn't even thinking they needed to do that day. And so there is a lot of push these days, a lot of advocacy for doing a simple finger prick in the doctor's office.
I feel really special that like I get to tell different people about JDRF and about what diabetes does to kids and how it makes them feel at certain times.
We are having a good time here with Rebecca and her mother, Wendy. Thank you guys for joining us. We're laughing, but Rebecca is doing such a great job with this, managing her diabetes. Is it as easy as it looks?
Sometimes yes and sometimes no.
Depending on the day and how everything's going. What's the most difficult part?
Being too high where I can't go to school, which is like yesterday.
How about when you're at school? Talk about how your friends react and how they're helping you as well.
Well, they always ask, oh, does that hurt? And I'm like, oh, I'm kind of used to it by now. And they're like, oh, can you have that? Are you sure you can have that? And I'm like, pretty sure I can have that. It's like, otherwise my mom wouldn't give it to me because I take my lunch every day.
Wendy, does she do a good job managing this?
She does. She does a great job. You know, she's grown up with it since she was two. And so really every year it's about giving her new goals, new things to do on her own. You know, unfortunately, when children are diagnosed, they kind of have to grow up very quickly.
Yeah.
And there's things they have to do that most of their friends don't have to do. So we always try to remember that first and foremost, she is a child or a tween now, but that we also have a lot of more responsibilities than maybe others do. And so part of the learning, part of the managing as she gets older is allowing her more autonomy with her type 1. And there are stumbles across the way with that, but that's how we learn to take care of it, because, you know, at some point she's going to want to go away and I'm not going to be packing my bags with her. Mm-hmm. So.
And real quick, talk about the technology, the increases you've seen since she was diagnosed 10 years ago.
That's true. We have seen technology just greatly improve, especially, I would say, over the last 5 years. But, you know, we've been at this now for 10 years. She wears an insulin pump that is tubeless. She wears a continuous glucose monitor that is checking her blood sugar every few minutes, and it graphs it, and it allows us to be proactive instead of always having to be reactive to the disease. Mm-hmm. And by using all of these tools to our best capabilities, it allows her to be this amazing,
herself.
You know, herself. Yeah. Absolutely. That's the best word for it, is she is herself.
Yeah.
And diabetes is second. You know, she plays tennis, she has sleepovers, she celebrated her birthday this weekend. I mean, she is the great American 12-year-old, absolutely.
Well, Wendy and Rebecca, we thank you both for joining us so much, and good luck and happy birthday, a little belated there.
Yeah, really.
Thanks a lot. Rick, let's go back to you at the phone banks. Tell me some folks are giving us a call.
They're giving some good calls in here, Vicki, tonight. 893-3232. Now, we have 8 phones here in the studio, and when all 8 are being used, if you call in, you might get a message that says, this number is out of service. It's not out of service. Just hang in there. Call us back. There's 4 phones on the front that are available to take your calls right now. So now that we've told you that, keep calling, folks. Sophie's going to help me out here. Sophie Hurst is going to keep me in line. You got to have a third grader to keep you up to date these days. In honor of Devin Kurth, David Kurth called in with a $500 pledge tonight. Thank you so much. In honor of Jude Sleed, Ingrid Isaac called in tonight with a $100 pledge. Thank you, Soph. Christopher King, a $33 pledge. And Darla Lindmayer with a $50 pledge in honor of Spencer. Thank you so much. I like to hear those phones ringing, don't you? All right, this is Debbie and Bob Murphy with a $50 pledge for Heidi Henneman. And Deanna Barber called in with a $50 pledge to help us out with the JDRF Telethon. Pauline Conover called in with a $10 pledge. Lisa Egger, thank you for your $50 donation tonight. Paul Adams with a $25 pledge. Owen Raymer called in with a $50 pledge tonight. See, I can get through so much with Sophie keeping me in line tonight here. Annie Sanders with a $15 pledge. And we thank you so much for that. And take a couple more. William Wilson, a $25 pledge. And it just says Carolyn called in tonight for Jenna Campbell with a $100 pledge. Keep those phones ringing in here tonight. We're taking pledges up until the top of the hour. Joyce Wise called in with $25, and Brenda Hazel with a $25 donation. Vicki, we like to hear the sound of those phones ringing. Let's go back to you.
We certainly do. Let's get the coming 893-3232. Everyone here tonight is affected by type 1 diabetes one way or another. Joining me now is Steve Luckett. Steve is the Vice President for Membership and Marketing at Baptist Health. He's also a JDRF board member. Steve, why is JDRF so important to you?
Well, the main reason is because my son, Chris, is a type 1 diabetic. He was diagnosed at 13, and obviously I want to do everything I can to find the cure my son's disease. So JDRF has been a very important part of my life.
Is JDRF making a difference?
Oh, yes, they are. The research has been tremendous. Chris was diagnosed several years ago. In the time that he's been diagnosed, the strides have been tremendous. Things like the artificial pancreas, the upcoming encapsulation, and these things are just huge. For something that seemed to take so long, all of a sudden it's just starting to explode. And it's very exciting. It's very exciting to be part of that cause.
You've been on the phone banks. You told me you took a $100 pledge earlier. Why is it so important for people to call in to donate money for research through JDRF?
Well, I think most importantly, 75 to 80% of the money that's donated does go right to research. And I think that's important because the cure is getting awfully close. And we're excited about making that happen, especially someone like me who wants their son to be cured. The faster we can make that happen, it's just important.
So you do believe you will see a cure for diabetes in your lifetime?
I think so. I'm excited.
I certainly hope so.
Well, thank you so much. I appreciate it.
Thanks for joining us. We appreciate it. Jay?
Okay, Vicki, thanks so very much. Hey, growing up, diabetes can present many challenges. For some, facing those challenges can provide some of life's greatest rewards. Emily Maha shares one man's story who climbed mountains to tackle his.
I mean, my mom will tell you that I climbed out of the crib. I had to be active.
Sitting still was never an option for Will Cross.
If I'm not active, I'm irritable.
But at 9 years old, Cross got the news no kid would ever want. He was diabetic.
I was devastating. I was an active kid. I was told I wouldn't be able to play sports, do anything strenuous. I was told I would die young. I was expected to live to 30.
But four decades later, Cross is pushing himself past all limits.
You know, it's not as Olympian as people I think might perceive.
He's become a world-recognized climber.
It started with an idea of walking to the pole, and I wanted to walk to the South Pole, and I wanted to do it because we were told that with diabetes it wasn't possible.
So far, Cross hiked to the summit of Mount Everest in 2006 and reached the highest point of the highest peak on each of the world's seven continents.
And I embraced that challenge. I thought, you know, I don't know if I can make it to the pole. I don't know if I can make it to the summit of Mount Everest, but I do know that I don't want diabetes to limit me.
He says prepping for climbs like those takes dedication and patience, traits he's learned living with diabetes.
A lot of the preparation is mental, you know, making all the small details, having those in place, and that sort of builds. And it, you know, in that sense, it's very much like diabetes care. You know, you've got to take care of the details, and your blood results will follow.
Cross shared his story with a new generation of kids growing up with diabetes at a pancake breakfast, a story that didn't come without its own challenges, but led to some of the greatest moments of Cross's life.
And then it's nice to have sort of made it through that journey and now be at the other end where I can say to kids whose age I once was, you know, this is entirely possible. You know, it's not as limiting, it's not as overwhelming as you might think it is.
Now, the pancake breakfast that Will Cross attended served as this year's One Walk kickoff event.
It was held August 14th at the Gaines Foundation Lodge at the Parklands of Floyd's Fork. The kickoff gives kids with type 1 diabetes an opportunity to meet other children who are battling the same battle. And at the same time, parents can get together to brainstorm fundraising ideas and goals for their walk teams. Anyone can start a team. All you have to do is go online, register, and start fundraising. Jay, maybe we need just to start a team.
Hear ya.
You can invite friends, coworkers, classmates, neighbors, anyone you want.
This year's walk will be held October 15th at Churchill Downs. I'll be there to MC the event once again. About 3,000 people will walk to help JDRF ease the incredible burden that type 1 diabetes has on millions and millions of people. This is a look at last year's walk, one of about 200 walks held across the country each year. It's the flagship fundraising event for JDRF and the largest type 1 diabetes event in the world. The family-friendly walk gives people with type 1 diabetes and their friends and coworkers the opportunity to have some fun while raising money for important research. We really hope you're going to be joining us this year. Again, that's coming up October 15th.
I like seeing the t-shirts, the caps, the slogans they have. Each team is unique in its own, and it's nice to see how they make it original.
Yeah, from start to finish, that is one fantastic event. There's food out there, there's drinks, there's music, of course, everything really pointing to find that cure for type 1.
And you're getting ready to work on the weather for that evening.
I know, right?
Let's go to Rick now, who's standing by in Studio A. Rick, we need to hear the phones.
Yeah, we sure do. A lot of pressure on Jay, though, Vicki, right? We got to get that weather right. That's the main thing. In here, once again, Sophie Hurst is helping me out. Now, we took in a call tonight, 893-3232. Keith Huber took the call in the back there. You'll hear from his daughter in just a little bit. $1,000 from Patrick and Mary King. Thank you all from the bottom of our hearts. Beverly Bratcher called in with a $50 pledge as well. This lovely little assistant here is an 8-year-old third grader. She has diabetes and she says she has to check her blood sugar 3 times a day, right? It gets old, that's for sure. That's why we're here raising money for JDRF. Kelly Wagger, $50, and Arthur Niffley, a $25 pledge. Now, we have 8 phones on our phone banks. Let me tell you something. If you call in and all the phones are busy, it's going to tell you that the phones have been disconnected. No, it's just instead of saying these phones are busy, just call back, okay? They're not disconnected. Once one of the phones opens up, the 2 down in the front here, you two, what do you, your phones need to start ringing. Make their phones ring, folks. All right, here's in memory of Jamie McCarty. Betty McCarty called in with a $250 pledge. Thank you, Betty. And Dave Edis called in with a $25 pledge. This is Margaret Evans called in with a $50 pledge tonight. And Cynthia Nichols called in $100. Every penny helps the kids, helps the adults. We're going to do away with this type 1 diabetes and with insulin going through the roof, the cost of it. We need all the help on research and funding, everything that we can get. Emily Murphy called in with a $50 pledge. And Lana Stoney called in with a $100 pledge. Thanks, Soph. Sue Davis called in with a $25 pledge. And Pamela Ruff, $100 tonight. Once again, we're here until 8 o'clock, 27 minutes. 8 phones. Oh, let's see, 7. We need to get Keith's phone ringing here. 893-3232 is the number. Mackenzie's on the phone taking a pledge. We will read them for you as much as we can. But for now, let's go back over to Jay and Vicki. Guys?
All right, thanks, Rick. 5 million people in the United States are expected to have type 1 diabetes by 2050, including nearly 600,000 youth.
JDRF has a youth ambassador program for children between the ages of 5 and 18. Now, to get involved in community awareness, volunteer efforts, and fundraising activities, and some of them are here with us tonight. Guys, we're going to go down the list here. I want you to introduce yourselves.
I'm Rebecca.
And we just talked to Rebecca a little bit ago.
We did.
I'm Trista.
I'm Jaden.
I'm Mary Rose.
I'm Maggie.
I'm Chris.
Chris, why be an ambassador? Why is this important to you?
Because I can tell other diabetics that are smaller than me that you can do anything that you want to do. You just got to watch your sugars and stuff.
And the outlook you guys have is just tremendous. How do you just keep spreading that to others? It's got to be tough from time to time. What do you think?
Yeah, it's a little tough from time to time, but it's encouraging to see other people at JDRF knowing that they're going through the same thing as you are. So that just like kind of boosts your spirits up. So it's good to like help donate and help us with that.
Okay.
So when you do meet kids, the other kids that have diabetes, does it make them feel good to know that you're a diabetic as well and that you can help them get through some of their problems?
I think it does. I've been involved with Camp Hendon, actually, which is a Kentucky diabetes camp for kids. I've been involved with that for about 10 years, and getting to see those little kids running around, you know, without a care in the world is really amazing, and I love doing that.
Are all of you guys going to the walk?
Yes.
Okay, let's talk t-shirts. What's your t-shirt going to look like? I know it's kind of a secret, but just give me a little preview.
My name's All-American Girl Team, and it has, like, the red, white, and blue flag on it, so.
Oh, very cool. And yours?
I'm Team Mary Rose, and I'm not exactly sure what mine's going to say yet, but one of my favorite slogans has been, slow down sugar, I'm diabetic.
Okay. Oh, I like that, yeah.
There's a big t-shirt contest, and the winners get a nice prize.
Oh, I like
prize,
the t-shirts,
so, yeah.
Yeah. It's the slogans and everything. That's a fun part of the walk, isn't it, to make it your own. Well, we appreciate you all joining us tonight. Of course, we're here to raise money for research. We want folks to give us a call so we can make a pledge. What would be the number they need to call?
893-3232.
Good job. We practiced that just
started
a little bit.
Started a little slow, but they got it.
893-3232. Give our ambassadors a call. We'd like to take your pledge.
Great job, guys.
Thanks a lot. Diabetes affects people of all ages and often when they least expect it.
Jennifer Bayless introduces us to two friends who were diagnosed with type 1 diabetes 1 week apart.
The twists and turns of life sometimes land us in unfamiliar territory.
Well, I was very sleepy and not energetic.
And that was far from what gymnast Madison Reeser was used to, exactly why her mother, Ashley, knew something was wrong.
She started going to the bathroom more frequently. She always had a constant need of thirst and had Googled those scenarios, and diabetes was one that came up.
Armed with that information and a list of symptoms, they went to the pediatrician.
It was a simple finger stick and a urine test, and within 5 minutes they came back and said that she was tested positive for diabetes.
Madison and her mother were shocked to find out it was type 1 diabetes because they had no family history of the disease.
I didn't know what it really was, and then until the doctors told me, like, I had to take insulin and prick my finger, then I knew that it was very hard.
It's basically an everyday, every hour management, controlled management. It's definitely been a huge life changer.
As they adjusted to their new life, they leaned on friends like Sarah Henderson and her son Griffin for support.
I don't really believe in coincidence. I do believe it's more of a God thing. I think that we were put together to help each other.
They quickly learned just how true that was. 1 week after Madison's diagnosis, her friend Griffin found out he too was diabetic.
My son woke up on the morning of December the 29th, day that we'll never forget, at about 6:30 in the morning, blood-curdling scream. We jump up out of bed. He had no frontal vision. He only had peripheral vision.
They rushed him to the ER and immediately started tests that revealed the seriousness of Griffin's condition.
They tell us that my son's blood sugar is 710. Which didn't mean anything because I said, well, what's it supposed to be? And they said between 80 and 120.
He spent 3 days in the hospital learning about the disease.
Between the COSAIR staff, the nurses, the doctors, and JDRF coming in and helping us understand what's going on, giving us kits, giving us tools, they made a horrible situation much better, much less frightening.
Madison and Griffin are back to being active adolescents. Both families have adjusted to life with type 1 diabetes, but now have a new focus.
A cure, obviously. Artificial pancreas would probably be the next step. Yeah. They're making such strides with that.
Yeah.
But with those strides comes the obvious, you need more research, you need more money, you need more funding.
We are here now with the Reesers and the Hendersons. It's all I can tell you folks, it's one big family. These are friends. They're having a lot of fun here. It's nice to meet all of you. Thank you for coming out. Why is it so important to support JDRF?
Well, JDRF has been a great organization for us. They bring so much awareness to the community and also just the help on finding a cure.
And Griffin, I saw that little story there. You have a heck of a little basketball shot there. Tell me about where do you go to school and how are you dealing with type 1 diabetes?
Well, I go to school at Eastside Middle School, and I'm used to it now for sure.
Yeah. Did it take a long time to get used to it, though?
Yeah.
With the help of your mom?
Yeah, mom and dad.
Sarah and Steve here? Okay.
Mm-hmm. Now, with your friend's brother having diabetes like you do, did it make it easier for you, or can you help him out more than he helps you out, or how does this work?
Well, we just kind of sit on our own.
He never asks you for questions or about how to handle something, if he can have a Twinkie or a Snickers bar.
No.
You'd be there to say no, right?
Yes. Okay.
Madison, tell me about what it's like to have a best friend and a brother with type 1 diabetes. How do you handle it? Because you handle it so well. Even though you're looking scared to death right now, it isn't scary because you're a pro at this, right?
I don't know.
Well, you're doing a wonderful job. See, there you go. So you help manage the whole thing, don't you?
She does. Yes.
Well, she's wonderful. In charge. Mom, why get involved with JDRF?
Because it's hope. Once your child is diagnosed and you realize how much your life is going to change, it is such a relief to have other families, other friends, and just a huge community to come out and help you. So that's what it means to us.
I said, this is one big family.
I know, right?
They are, yes.
Real quick, I just want to ask Steve, I want to ask Dad something here. Looking forward now, we've had a lot of huge success as far as technology goes. What do you want to see in the future? I know a cure, no doubt about it, but in the immediate future?
Just to make it more manageable for them. Not the finger pricks and the shots and just easier on them because it's tough to watch them struggle every day.
I hear you.
We don't want to leave you out. Are you excited for the walk? Will you wear your sister's T-shirt? What's your team? Her team going to be?
Tell her.
You don't know? Oh, you do know?
It's Madison's Messengers.
Madison's Messengers. So you've got your slogan, your T-shirts picked out. What colors?
It's going to be teal.
Teal. With the time.
Now,
right?
We're going to be out there, so I want to see a
we're
great
look for you
T-shirt.
Guys.
I mean, I want to be blown away, all right?
Thank you all for joining us. We certainly appreciate you being here
guys.
Tonight. Rick, that should get the phones ringing. One big happy family here.
Yeah, they're great folks, that is for sure. When you see Madison come tumbling in here again, that would help get the phone ringing. We have 8 on the phone bank. So far, we've got 6 of them, 5 of them working. We need to get all of them ringing. I've got a special little gift here, a call in from Debbie and Bobby Waits, better known to this young lady as Mimi and Poppy. What do you want to say to them? $250 donation for Sophia and Wyatt.
Thank you, Mimi and Poppy.
There you go. Thank you so much. Deborah Lane called in with a $25 pledge for us tonight. Mary Fulkerson, a $100 pledge. Thank you so much. And John Rocky called in with a $50 pledge for JDRF. Again, the numbers 893-3232. And if you get something that says it's disconnected at this time, that just means that all 8 phone lines are busy. Call back. They're not disconnected. They're just all busy right now. Katie McGee called in with a $50 donation. Norma Etheridge called in with a $25 pledge. And we want to thank John Schroering with a $10 pledge and Karen Webb, $10 as well. We take anything and everything, folks, because this is an important cause and it all adds up in the end. Jacqueline Wasson called in with a $20 pledge tonight. 893-3232, the numbers. Angus McDouglas, $100. John Sherberb with a $100 pledge. Let's see what we have, Sophia. Let's see, Linda Grober with a $40 pledge. David Masterson called in with a $100 pledge. And we like to see all these papers coming in here. Keep them ringing. Don's there on the back phones taking given his time to help JDRF force tonight. Robin Pryor called in with a $10 pledge. Gary Swope with a $30 pledge. Thank you so much, Gary. Barbara Hanna, $100 tonight. This is for Natalie. And Lauren Satterfield called in with a $25 pledge. Lanny Mopperdier, $100. And Jean Brown called in with a $100. You're on TV there. Look at you, Sophie. Smile. Mimi and Poppy called in a little bit earlier and gave a donation in your honor. Kathy Hawkinsmith, $50. Kathy Lauren, $100 pledge tonight. And we want to thank Neil Tyler, $25, dedicated to Lorali, 8 years, Laura Lee, rather, 8 years old. Jonathan Hardy called in with a $30 pledge. This is for daughter Natalie as well. Let me read one more, and then I'll throw it back over to Jay and Vicky. Christine Strothman, $50. Katie Massey, $50. Keep those phones ringing. We're in the stretch run. 15 more minutes left to go on this telethon here at WLKY to help out JDRF and all the kids like Sophie here, Sophie Hurst. 893-3232. Let's go back over to Jay and Vicky, guys.
Thanks, Rick. As we've been talking about throughout the night, on October 15th, thousands of people will gather for the JDRF One Walk at Churchill Downs.
Yeah, there are three types of teams: family, corporate, and schools or youth. One of the many dedicated volunteers here with us tonight is family team chair Debbie Cannon. Debbie, thanks so very much for joining us. Appreciate it.
Thank you for having us.
Say, this is your 13th year for this walk.
It is our 13th year. My twin girls, Jaden and Devin, both have type 1 diabetes. They are 16. Jaden was diagnosed at age 4, and Devin was just diagnosed 3 years ago.
You said you were really not surprised, since they were twins, that she was diagnosed with diabetes. Just came a little later than her sister, but you said she will not be as sick or be as affected with this because of the way that she found out.
Well, she found out through TrialNet, which is just a finger prick, a blood test, mm-hmm. and we were able to find out early and take proactive measures and start controlling it with diet before she had to start insulin. So she will never get as sick as her sister did. That's correct.
And you were telling us that ever since you started volunteering years ago, you've seen some tremendous, very positive changes. Talk a little bit about that.
Oh, my goodness. Technology is amazing, and over the years I've noticed a tremendous difference. Management is easier, and I know my girls will live longer, healthier lives because of everyone's support and the money that comes in, the money that the walk raises. So it's nice to actually see that firsthand.
Tell us about the walk. Is it too late to get a team together?
Oh my goodness, no. The walk is the most exciting day. It's the one day of year. It's fun to have type 1 diabetes, believe it or not. You have about 6,000 people that come together at Churchill Downs, which is October 15th. Registration is at 11, and the walk kicks off at 12:30. They have all kinds of games, inflatables, music, food, and it's just amazing. It's at Churchill Downs to watch 6,000 people come together all for the same cause.
So do you need to register before then or that day? Or
we'd love for you to register beforehand at www.jdrf.org if you can, or you can register the morning of at 11 a.m.
And of course, the weather's always great.
The weather is always wonderful.
That's because Jay hosts the event, so he's Jay out there with his poncho and his umbrella.
Always ready, right?
It doesn't matter. The 6,000 people don't care if it's rain or shine.
We don't care at all. We're just glad you're all there.
Debbie, thank you so much for joining us tonight.
Thank you.
Tell your daughters that we send our best to them.
I will. Thank you so much. Thank you, Debbie. Thank you both.
Now, while people with type 1 diabetes may struggle with their disease daily, their abilities are not limited.
And sometimes you can't even tell someone has the disease. Take a look.
Hi, my name is Kendall Simmons, former Pittsburgh Steelers Super Bowl champion. As someone who lives with type 1 diabetes, I totally support JDR's mission in creating a world without type 1 diabetes. Research does not happen without funds, so we ask you please donate to JDRF, and together we can turn type 1 into type 9.
Some other professional athletes with type 1 diabetes: Bears quarterback Jay Cutler, snowboarder Sean Busby, and Cincinnati Red and former U of L baseball player Adam Duvall.
Isn't that amazing? I mean, this is so wide.
So you're not limited.
No, you're really not.
Does it put any restrictions on you?
We got to get these phones ringing.
I don't hear them.
I don't hear them
Rick,
either.
We need the phones to ring. 893-3232.
Yeah, let's get those phones ringing. I've got some more help. Griffin Henderson is here. And then the young lady on the end, you heard Vicky and Jay talk to her a little bit earlier. Madison, your grandparents called in with a donation tonight. Do you want to thank them?
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Bottom of your heart. Maybe we can get you doing flips. Yeah, there we go. She'll do a flip for us here. Okay. Keep the phones ringing here. 893-3232. I'm putting them all to work here. We've got a chain now. We're getting so many of phone calls. In honor of Bobby Hall, $25. Naomi Smith called in with a $50 check. And we have, the great-grandfather, Poppy, called in with another donation of $100 for Sophia and Wyatt. Hey, that's pretty nice. You got your other grandparents to call in. Say thanks.
Thank you.
All right. Larry Whalen called in honor of Jordan Whalen and Braxton Basham. And Raydeen Ray called in with a $100 pledge tonight. All right, you're supposed to pass them down, Griffin. Madison, you're supposed to pass. There we go. There we go, girls. Get them together. Now you're supposed to go back there, Madison. Get some more. Good girl. I have them trained by the time this program's over. We got 10 minutes. Come on. Step it up, guys. Teresa Riggs called in with a $100 pledge. Kaylee Adams called in with a $50 pledge tonight. And Ken Kalen with a $50 pledge in memory of Aaron Kalen. And Diane Trockless with a $50 pledge tonight. And Dan Lockard called in with a $500 pledge. Thank you so much. And James Mitri in honor of Hannah Moody and Andrew Moody. Thank you so much for your pledge. 893-3232. Keep the phones ringing. We're going to talk to this young lady here in just a minute, and we'll get her story as she has type 1 diabetes, and she's here tonight volunteering and helping us out. A lot of people. There's Don Riggs. He's also busy on the phones all night long. 893-3232. Let's go back to Jay and Vicky.
Thanks, Rick. About 40,000 people are diagnosed with type 1 diabetes each year in the United States.
Dr. Sarah Watson is an endocrinologist at the Wendy L. Novak Diabetes Center. Dr. Watson, thank you very much for joining us. First thing I want to ask you is, you know, there's still a lot of questions in people's mind exactly what is type 1 diabetes. Explain that to us, if you would.
So there are two types of diabetes, type 1 and type 2.
Right.
Type 1 diabetes has nothing to do with the food you eat or how much exercise you get. It's an autoimmune disease. So your body gets confused and starts destroying the cells that make insulin. And you have to have insulin to live. It's important so that you can use the food that you eat for energy.
Mm-hmm. What are some of the warning signs that you have diabetes or particularly type 1?
So the warning signs are that you have increased thirst. So the kiddos are drinking a lot more, going to the bathroom mm-hmm. a lot more. Some of them can lose weight. And you also can be more hungry, have increased appetite
okay.
as well.
Is it hereditary then, or?
So there is a genetic component. So you inherit a tendency to develop type 1 diabetes.
A tendency. Doesn't mean you're always going to get it then.
That's correct.
It's just, we don't know for sure.
That's right. And then something in the environment sets it off.
Okay.
And we're not quite sure what that is.
Okay.
But there's a genetic component.
No cure yet, but are strides being made?
We have a lot better treatments, and there's a lot of work on a biologic cure as well. So there's work on the artificial pancreas, which is going to improve treatment and use technology that is an insulin pump device along with a continuous glucose monitor. So those two devices will help manage the blood sugars. They'll have a catheter or a small tube that stays under the skin to deliver insulin, and another one that kind of measures that sugar level so that they can control it.
I know it's impossible to say for sure, but when do you think this is going to be maybe cured? I mean, I know, I get it, but are we 10, 20, 30 years out? Is it just, we just don't know?
I'd like to hope so, but a lot of it depends on the availability of resources to do research, which is why organizations like the JDRF are so important in this mission.
Okay. Dr. Sarah Watson, thank you so much for joining us. We certainly appreciate it.
Thank you.
All right. Living with type 1 diabetes is not easy, but all you can see from all of these amazing kids and adults who have joined us throughout this hour, they don't let it stop them from living life and chasing their dreams.
Yeah, we met this next young lady 2 years ago, and she continues her inspirational journey today. Photojournalist Scott Eckhart showed us Carolyn Smith's story and her fight to find a cure.
My name is Caroline. I am 13 years old. I am just your typical teenage girl. I text, FaceTime, and love to shop. People say I'm strong and determined. My mom says I am her hero. I say I really am just like everyone else my age, except I have type 1 diabetes.
There was nothing Caroline did to bring this on. There was no way we could have prevented it. There was no way we could have seen it coming.
That is?
Yeah. From the moment we came home from the hospital, our lives changed. Type 1 diabetes is a 24/7 illness, disease. It never stops. There are no breaks.
Where's our class? We're gonna be late.
Although this is my diagnosis and I have taken charge of it, I do not walk alone.
I'm gonna finish painting this.
As difficult as it is, I have never allowed any of us to say, why us? Why Caroline?
Look at that. I know.
I have no doubt that she can do it, but sometimes letting that go is hard.
We chose like the hardest project.
We try to allow her to lead a typical life. She's a 13-year-old girl, and she deserves that.
I will not allow this disease to win. I will not let this disease get in my way of my hopes and dreams and my future. I did nothing to deserve this. I did not ask for this illness, and I long for the day it is no more. I like swimming too much to stop, so I deal with what I am given. Swimming is my outlet. When I swim, I am in my own world and can block out any distractions. It's not always easy, but I do what I have to do. I must advocate for myself, even if it is difficult.
She's just been a very incredibly tough kid. She doesn't let it get her down. She doesn't enjoy it, but handles it very well.
I will spend each day living life to the fullest. I will show diabetes who is boss.
I pray every day that there is a cure. We do all that we can to support the efforts of JDRF and their fundraising so that we can support research that will one day lead to a cure. One day there will be that breakthrough. We would never say, why us? Why Caroline? Because for me, I say, why not us? Why not? I always compare diabetes to a game, and it's a game we play every day, and it's a game where the rules change every day, and nobody tells you that they changed. So what worked yesterday for us may work today, but probably won't work tomorrow. This gives us an opportunity to educate. It gives us the opportunity to help raise funds for JDRF. I always say you never know. That next penny you raise could be the penny that helps lead to a cure.
I dream of a cure. I dream of the day I do not have to prick my finger 6 times a day. I dream of the day when I can eat whatever I want, whenever I want. I will live my life fighting for a cure. JDRF is leading the way to a cure. Every donation will make a difference. Every donation will take us one step closer to my dream of finding a cure.